So we're on page 93, and Walter A. Sark says that Glendora enjoyed a rare victory in the White Plains City Court. Oh, a rare victory. See, they put in these things just to inflame you and to get your mind and get the court's mind off of the aggravement of the situation, is that Cecilia had no meritorious defense for a default judgment. She simply didn't show up. And there, the appellate court, which would be McCabe, Rudolph, and Littman, are endorsing that. Don't have any respect for courts. You don't have to go to court. Don't go. That's okay. She defaulted. There's nothing wrong with that. See, they just turn the law upside down to fit their own selfish purposes. Sarek is saying this to get me off the point, that that's what Cecilia did wrong and should have been punished for, and should have paid the $5,000. And he says it's a rare victory, but what was so rare about the victory? When Cablevision took a chat with Glendora off of TV in Nassau County, and three courts ordered them to put it back on. Oh, that was such a rare victory. That's sort of three big victories right there. What about the victory in the Harrison Court when the crooks who were running Cablevision, Public Access, ruined Glendora's broadcast TV commercial, damaged it, and Glendora sued them to replace it, and they lost? What was so rare about this victory? There have been many, many victories. Who beat Cablevision Charles Dolan in the Rye City Court in 2002? Glendora has beaten Cablevision all over the place. But this is just to get your mind off of the fact that Cecilia Mastrovilli was in default. And she cheated. And she's to be rewarded for that. It was one rare victory after the other. Who got Sarok's sick order to show cause denied? Who got the second identical order to show cause denied? Who beat Callaghan Sadley and Cablevision in the Second Circuit, the U.S. Court of Appeals, in 1995, and made Cablevision Nassau County put Glendora back on TV? Who beat Callaghan Sadley and the Dolans in the Supreme Court, Westchester, in 1995? Who beat Callaghan Sadley and the Dolans in the U.S. District Court, the Southern District of New York? Who beat former Cablevision and Dolan in the Harrison Court in 1998, and who beat Sadley, Callaghan, and Charles Dolan and Cablevision in the Rye City Court in 2002? And this is to be continued, and we are on page 94. Sarok says the appellant moved on September 27th. She didn't. Sarok moved. It's another lie. By order to show cause to vacate the default judgment. And pursuant to CPLR 5015, well, we don't do pursuant to CPLR 5015 in small claims court. We use the applicable law, which is the Small Claims Act, Uniform City Court Act 1801, section. Improperly served with the Glendora's verified complaint. Well, it was not, and the court said it was not improperly served, and that's just a lie and a dodge. He can't defend on the merits. Has Sarok any credibility left, my dears? I ask you, does this man, Walter A. Sarok, have any credibility left? Here's a Park Avenue lawyer groveling avariciously over $5,020. Here is Charles Dolan, $3 million a year he gives himself, and he gives his son James Dolan $3 million a year. And he's groveling over $5,000. Sarok has no respect left for himself. He has stooped so low. He does not know that plaintiff, Glendora, speaks first and closes last. He doesn't know that. He doesn't know procedure. He doesn't know protocol. He cannot read. He cannot read the Small Claims Act, and he cannot read the Uniform City Court Act, Section 1801, exequatur. Nor the Small Claims Guide, You can't even read that. And this is all for $5,020. Business must be bad at 230 Park Avenue, folks, in the Pan Am building. Sarok says that they denied his jurisdictional motion, and this is what he appealed to the appellate term. Sarok doesn't know that a decision on a motion cannot be appealed. Only an order or a judgment can be appealed. The appellate term, Mr. McCabe, Mr. Rudolph, and Mr. Lippman, you don't know that a decision on a motion cannot be appealed. You have to have an order or a judgment. Don't you know that, appellate term? Even the ghostwriter for the appellate term did not fall for this one, did not fall for this ambage. Master Really did no such thing. Sarok did it. Master Really didn't appeal this and that. Sarok did it. And Sarok says show cause to vacate the default judgment under CPLR 5015. Well, that is not the law. The law we're dealing with in small claims court is the Small Claims Act, the Unified City Court Act, Section 1801. Well, here's a bunch of lies by Sarok. You cannot ask the court for the same relief twice. You should know that, Sarok. But you know, they're like Cablevision. They know the law, they'll go ahead and do it anyway. They will break the law deliberately, with no respect, and with no Americanism. Sarok did not even show up at his own trial. He was too cowardly, and he did not even send a representative. I sued Sarok. Press was right. White Pine City Court Press was right. A White Pine City part-time judge knows more than you people on the appellate term, McCabe, Rudolph, and Lippman. Sarok is up to line 256. The appellate decision was a cheat. It was nothing more than a cheat. It's right there. You can read it. It's a cheat. It improperly reversed the decision and vacatur and vacated the default judgment. Sure, you don't have any respect for the court. You don't have to show up in court. Go ahead, Cecilia. Don't show up in court. And these cheaters will stand behind it. Go ahead and cheat America. Go ahead and cheat the court system. The court determined that moving to vacate a default judgment on the grounds that the appellant had a reasonable excuse. Well, she had no reasonable excuse. And there was never any proof of it. And you never had any proof of it. I ask you, McCabe, Rudolph, and Lippman, when are you ever going to learn to be judges? You are disqualified. Step down. On the grounds that the appellant had a reasonable excuse for defaulting and a meritorious defense, there's another big lie. She had no meritorious defense. Where's the proof from the doctors? Was she on the witness stand? It's all conclusory. An entirely different application than a motion to vacate on jurisdictional grounds. Why don't you deal with the merits? Okay, we are up to page 97. And Sarok's line number 258. In order to obtain leave to re-argue, well, I didn't want leave to re-argue, and I didn't ask to re-argue, and he goes on and makes believe and lies that I did. That's how they do it. They just have no conscience. They had bad parents. They didn't teach them right from wrong. They don't know right from wrong. Glendora asked for relief. Not re-argument. And it's another bald-faced lie by Sarok, and he's up to number 260. And Sarok says that Glendora fails to address the fact that substantive motions presented entirely independent grounds for dismissal, and the appellate decisions holding that there is no bar in the bringing of succession motions under CPLR 5015. Oh, yes, there is. They will take the law, black letter law, and they will twist it, and they will spin it, and they will turn it wrong side out, any which way it pleases them. But the one thing that they won't do is justice, their job. Glendora presented the same grounds. The second order to show cause asked for the same relief twice by Sarok, and you don't do that. You do not ask a court for the same relief twice. Rudolph, McCabe, Lippman, and their ghostwriter, and Sarok are adjuncts. The appellate term failed dismally to act honestly and honorably. And the appellate term cheated. And the appellate term is being sued for fraud. There's a lot to sue the appellate term for. And again, I'm going to show you the definition of fraud. N, intentional perversion of truth for the purpose of inducing another in reliance upon you to part with some valuable thing belonging to you. Has this happened to you? To surrender a legal right? False representations? Of a matter of fact, this is what Sarok does repeatedly, and so do McCabe, Rudolph, and Lippman. Whether by word or by conduct, by false or misleading allegations of or concealment of that which should have been revealed, disclosed, which deceives and is intended to deceive another, so that he shall act upon it to his legal injury. Now that's fraud, and that's what you have done, Rudolph. That's what you have done, McCabe. That is what you have done, Mastrilli. That is what you have done, Saffarino. That is what you have done, Sara. That is what you have done, Satterley, Stevens, Jerk, and Jerk. And that is what you have done, ghostwriter, law clerk, stealing $70,000 a year from taxpayers. Sarok is up to lie 265. He says that Mastrilli presented a meritorious defense. Well, she did not. And where was the medical proof? Where was it? I keep asking you that. You keep dodging it. You can't answer it. Where was the medical proof that she thought her employer would undertake the defense for her? Well, who said? Was anybody sworn as a witness who said that? No. It's all hearsay. And that's what you ruled on, Rudolph, McCabe, and Lippman. You had bad parents, that's all. You didn't have parents that taught you from right from wrong. We are up to page 100. In addition to his lies, first of all, Mastrilli did nothing. Sarok did it all. And he has to take all the blame. And in addition to his lies and lack of acuity and heterotaxies, sometimes Sarok smells of dementia. You know, it's one thing to lie, and it's one thing to misrepresent And it's another thing to be crazy. He actually does insane things. No way could Sarok say that he had a meritorious defense. From Savarino, Master Uli had no meritorious defense for missing the summons August the 24th, 2005, and misrepresent and lie as much as he could. Sarok could never produce a meritorious defense, even with the appellate term acting as Sarok's defense counsel. No meritorious defense was ever presented. Now I'm going to sue all of these judges in the appellate term, McCabe and Rudolph and Lippman and Tannenbaum and Angiolo and McCarver for fraud, but also for violating my constitutional rights, my due process of law. And indeed, the appellate term acted as Sarok's defense. Sarok tries to get by quoting bad decisions by bad judges, and that's all they are. Here comes my friend Ruth, helping me, just a second. She brought me pine salt. This is the best, and there are no substitutes. Here, you want to smell it? Oh, that smells so good. This is smell-o-vision, isn't it? Smell it. Isn't that good? And it's $1.79 at Aldi's. And I think it's only 99 cents that save a lot. But I'm not sure of that. Thanks. Now I can clean my bathroom today. So where were we? We're up to page 100. Well, I guess we got the fact through that the appellate term cheated. And it's a record that's going to live forever. Master really did nothing. Sarok did it all. He has to take all the blame. And in addition to his lies and his lack of acuity, I told you that I think that he has a problem with dementia. There's no way he can say that he had a meritorious defense. He just lies for money. And in this case, I wonder if he's getting any money. But he just lies for money that he got previously that he shouldn't have got. From square one, Master Uli had no meritorious defense for missing summons August the 24th, 2005, and misrepresent and lie as much as she could. Sarok too, could never produce a meritorious defense. Even with the appellate term acting as Sarok's defense counsel, no meritorious defense was ever presented. And that is page 100. We only have 20 more to go. Fine feathered friends, for a duck may be somebody's mother. So we are up to page 101 to 116, 114, that finishes it. And we are right, R-I-G-H-T, to right, W-R-I-T-E, on television, on paper, and on the World Wide Web. Even. Sarok even goes to the graveyard to exhume Calagy's papers. No meritorious defense could be disinterred. But this is a type of maggotry that the appellate term McCabe, Rudolph, Littman feeds on. See their record on paper by Glendora, on TV, and on the World Wide Web. Last night, a viewer came from Long Island, or a viewer rather called from Long Island, and played the audio over the phone. And Glendora could hear Glendora talking about Rudolph, McCabe, and Tannenbaum. About Littman, Angiolillo, LaCava, and their ghostwriters. It was shocking. Isn't it shocking that at $136,000 plus a year, they cannot write their own papers? They have to have a ghostwriter, and that costs us another $70,000 a year? And add to this that they cannot read a caption and they cannot sign their own names. Now here's Law of Sarok, line number 267. Employer was mentioned by name in the statement of the nature of the action. Moreover, Glendora, well, Sarok never mentioned Cecilia's employer. It was Christine Savarino. Glendora has brought Savarino to law in the Yonkers court. Every time and every line is a lie by Sarok, and it has to be cut out, and it has to be refuted. Well, voila. Failed to make any showing in the complaint that would be sufficient to hold Master Riley personally liable in this matter. This is an ignominious cop-out. Your stand will be neon-lighted forever. Was this worth $5,020? It leaks like a sieve. I would rather be I than you any day. This is open and shameful disregard of decency. You had bad parents, Sarok. You had bad parents, McCabe, Rudolph, and Littman. And your grandparents were bad, never teaching your parents right from wrong. Sarok is up to his number 268 lies, and he only wrote 18 pages. There are only 10 more lies to refute, folks. We're on page 103. Glendora, he says, claims that it was a small claims action for damages, thereby improperly suggesting that she did not have to allege liability in order to state a claim. Not at all. It was a small claims damage suit. That's all it was. And to get away from the truth of it, Rudolph and McCabe and Littman and Sarok go into civil practice laws and rules. the New York Code. It was as simple, and still is, small claims action for damages. And Glendora proved her damages in her abdomen. It was a small claims action for damages. It was a small claims action for damages. Pure and simple. Glendora is pure, and you are simple. Master really perniciously chased away Glendora's signers in order to censor Glendora off of TV. She got caught. Glendora had to expend way in excess of $5,020 to find new signers. Compelling signers has no statutory authority. Note that Sarok has not produced any. Sarok and his defense counsel, Rudolph, McCabe, Lippman, and Ghostwriter, have provided no statutory authority for compelling us to have signers. Sarok has produced no Carmody weight proof of authority to represent. We do not even know if he is a lawyer. We don't even know if he has a union card from the American Bar Association Union. We know he is not licensed by the state of New York as our doctors and veterinarians. Neither are Rudolph, McCabe, Lippman, or their ghostwriter. Glendora's motion is improperly and primarily devoted to ad hominem attacks. Well, it's not ad hominem. That means to the man. It's ad deum, which means to God. And he says improperly, and Glendora crosses out the im. Till all success be nobleness in liberty and law. It was nice in those days. It isn't anymore. And deum is winning over hominem. You, plural, have made the wrong choice. In voice, you should invoke your self-possession. It is not too late. But for Calagy, it is. Sarok fails to refute what Glendora has written and read on TV. Ergo, it is the truth, and it stands. And he loses in its entirety. 105. The judges that rendered the appellate decision, well, they didn't, what they rendered was making the courts meaningless. That's what they rendered. And this is Starrock's line number 274. And he says that Glendora's claims, well, they aren't claims, they're proofs. A bias, however, are wholly conclusory. Oh yeah, I only presented something like 70 pages of their bias. Mm-hmm. And need not be considered by the court. Well, yes, you'd better consider them, court. You're already sued on enough things. You had better consider them, court. And everything that Glendora says is res ipsa locator. Things. speak for themselves. And he cites a case, and what do I tell you about this case law? Oh, I shouldn't have said that. That there's no such thing as case law. It's a contradiction, because cases do not make law, and judges do not make law. Legislators make law. That's why we happen to have three different chambers of government. Did you ever hear of that? Executive, legislative, and judicial. Did you ever hear of that? It's just another bad judge by another, another bad decision by a bad judge. What is conclusory is this aberrant paragraph written by Juvenal Sara. Deviation from what is right, natural, and moral. His parents made the wrong choice. Glendora is exuberant that there are no pay raises for state judges. Make them pay us for ruining our courts. $136,000 plus what these judges get, and that's times six of them. What have you got here? You got over $500,000, all wasted in their slop. And $70,000 for two ghostwriters. That amounts to a ripoff. Make them return it to us. And zap their pensions. And that's what the 14th Amendment says, if they don't take an oath and keep it. Three, lose their job. Four, lose their pensions. Bye-bye. Decompressed. Bye-bye is decompressed version of God be with you. Bye-bye. Decompressed version of God be with you. And you be with God. So we're up to page 106. And take a look at how Sara changes his signature again. And what is it? It's proof that inside of his head, it's muddled, it's empty, it's confused. And it's unsound. Sarek lies that he is the attorney for Master Riley. He has no proof of that. He's been asked dozens of times to produce his Carmody Waite proof of authority to represent. It's not hard. If he's Master Riley's attorney, then say so. Have her write an affidavit. Have her just write an affidavit. That's how simple it is. But you see, he doesn't do that, so that just shows you guilty. Remember that Glendora moved for relief, not argument, re-argument. And Glendora wants Sarok sanctioned, $10,000, pursuant to Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 11, for his misrepresentations. It is even more obvious that Rudolph Conclave should quash Sarek's papers. Another thing, I tell you again, he did not serve them by regular mail. Now, a good court would, but Rudolph, McCabe, and Lippman are a bad court. We're up to page 107. Sarek does not serve by regular mail. Watch the Rudolph Conclave ignore this or cover it up for him. He does not represent Master Riley. No Carmody Waite proof has been given. If he did, it is easy enough to write an affidavit saying so. The same applies to Glendora's case in Harrison and Glendora case in the Phillipstown court. Everything that Sarok says is hearsay. He is a latecomer. He was not there. He does not swear under penalty of perjury that he is telling the truth. He does not defend on the merits. He has no meritorious defense. He cites no applicable law, specifically the Uniform City Court Act, Section 1801 et sequitur. He has no defense against Glendora. 44 pages are undefended, and hence establishes all the points in Glendora's favor. Everything is conclusory. There's no witnesses, there's no testimony, there's no evidence. It is all rhetoric. It is not court. Master really still can't cable cast functionally. Two nights ago, the show in Yorktown was not on the TV. And they have flubbed so many times. Why, at least 20 times. It was a blank screen. Adjudge means to decide, determine, and pronounce judicially, to order or to decree. This case has not been adjudged. Adjudicate means to hear or try and determine judicially, to settle by judicial decree, and to act as a judge. These people have not acted as a judge. They have not settled by judicial decree, and they have not heard and tried, and they have not determined judicially. They didn't sign a paper. Rudolph, McCabe, and Lippman did not do any of these things. That is a gravamen. Compound this with the big gravamen that they violated Glendora's constitutional rights, and by the 14th Amendment, points 3 and 4, they are to be fired and to lose all pensions and benefits. There are no pay raises for state judges. They didn't make it. 3:30 p.m. I would like to rejoice about the trustworthiness of the universe. You go to sleep at night, and it's there in the morning, and it has been for billions of years. No pay raises for state judges. Make them pay us for ruining our courts. Courts are to protect the people, and they have robbed us of that. We have no protection. We have just dirty lawyers like Sarok and dishonest judges like McCabe, Rudolph, Lippman. Angiolillo, Tannenbaum, and McCover. This hymn I wanted to sing to them. In fact, to all of us. Lord, dismiss us with thy blessings. Fill our hearts with joy and peace. Let us each thy love possessing triumph in redeeming grace. Oh, refresh us, traveling through this universe, this beautiful, magnificent, thrilling universe. Take notice that Glendora called her post office and it was closed at 12:15 p.m. Friday, and she doesn't know if Sarok ground out a fourth paper about the Rye City court case, Glendora versus Charles F. Dolan and Cablevision. And she will not know until Monday, April the 23rd. But she will spend hours 3, 4, and 5. I made this 5 hours a day. I made myself do this 5 hours a day. I didn't make myself sit down and do it until I finished it. I made myself do it 5 hours a day. So the rest of it was 2 hours to get up to writing it this far, and the next 3 hours I spent printing it. And I got up to 30 pages. So Saturday, I printed more. And I got up to something like 60 pages. And I kept printing. And by Monday, I had it all printed. Then all day yesterday, Tuesday, I was collating it, doing the envelopes, addressing the envelopes, return address and addressing them, and videotaping the envelopes for you. And then, finally, at 3:30 yesterday afternoon, this paper was served, April the 24th, 2007, Anno Domini. And to whom did it go? You know that because I read it to you. I sent it to Judith Kay to show her how state judges do not deserve a raise. I sent it to the executive director of the American Bar Association, and I said, here are 8 lawyers. I think 6 of them judges. No, maybe 8 of them. Here's 10 lawyers. 8 of them judges who make you look pretty bad, the American Bar Association. And I didn't send one to the Commission on Judicial Conduct. I should. 3 should go to who to sue. They're all going to be sued. As I say, it is not grammatical, but it is graphic. And we're up to the a fortiori. The a fortiori. Therefore, wherefore, ergo, all the more, and even with greater force, it is even more certain and necessary that the relief that Glendora requested for relief be granted, together with costs and any further relief that is just and proper. This is Opus 1474, 1475, and 1476. That would be how many legal papers I had written. The cost of it was $106.92 to print and to post. And that's with my doing the printing on the little desk copier. Now, let's see if we get anywhere close to this. Internet number circa 4,590. Edition 21 to 4,600, edition 31, half hours. You think we got even close to that? Service on the 2 internet sites is by electronics. Yours in truth, in amor patriae, love of one's country. In amor New Yorki, love of the state of New York. And in outrage at the depravity of judges, lawyers, clerks, and courts. And it is signed with a signature I'm pretty sure you can read. Without prejudice, it's from the Uniform Commercial Code, Article 1, 207. A chat with Glendora on 55 TV stations. I don't know, it may be more than 550 municipalities on Albany, New York, the state capital, and in Washington, D.C., the nation's capital. And on the World Wide Web on two sites, www.achatwithglendora.com and www.youtube.com. /Glendora. It is read. The record is made on TV and all over the world. Okay. So what were we doing? We were going to look through the drawers. And we were going to find the bulletins to read you. You want to hear some music? I would like to commend Anthony Cerro for his paper, The Liberty Proclaimer, where he is man enough and brave enough to stand up for America, no matter what. And I sent him $20. It's non-profit, of course, 3013C. And I found out about this through Chris Hsu. And Chris Hsu, I enjoyed meeting you so much because you are a real thinker. Okay, that's bulletin one. Where is he? He's up in Warren County, Washington County, up near Lake George and all those places. This letter came from the New York Medical College. And Franklin Fuller Buell, my husband for 48 years, donated his body to the New York Medical College because some of the medical students have to take a hiatus because they don't have a cadaver to work on. And it says, the future physicians of the class of 2010 of New York Medical College, as well as our entire university community, are most thankful to you for the generous gift of the body of Franklin Buell. And it's spelled correctly, with a Y, Franklin with a Y. The students learn so much from this gift that they shall be forever grateful. They will most certainly be able to serve their patients better during their future careers. By whom is this written? On Friday, May the 18th, 2007, at 12:30 p.m., the students, faculty, and college community will conduct a memorial service, a convocation of thanks. You are cordially invited to join with us in this service, which will be held in the Nevins Auditorium in the Medical Education Center. And it gives you parking spaces, and in behalf of all those whose lives and careers have been enriched by your thoughtfulness and generosity, I extend our thanks. Thank you. I want to thank Mary Ramage for her letter. And she's so good. She monitors closely the Yorktown Cablevision system. She wants, of course, to know what's going on, because she is the signer there, and she says it's her show. But she loves to see .com, and she loves to see Sebastian. And so she writes her letters, and she even writes in her letters what she saw on the screen. And she has excellent penmanship. That's Mary Ramage in Mohegan Lake, which is a hamlet of Cortland. Andrew Herzman works for NBC. He has something to do with putting NBC on cell phones. I would like to thank my niece for the lovely Easter card. Isn't this pretty? The post office has come forth with so many cartoons, and they're so cute. So I think that's a nice touch. And here's another nice letter from Mary Ramage. See, I think of you all the time. Here's tenants and neighbors, you people who live in Westchester County, Rockland County, and New York City. Those five counties. New York City is a city with five counties in it. I send them $4 whenever I can. And here's an alert for you. I'll read it to you quickly. You tenants who are beleaguered by avaricious landlords. They want Spitzer to continue to support our tenants, and the landlords are abusing major capital improvements. If a landlord makes a major capital improvement, he can assess the tenants for it and increase their rents by it, and these landlords are cheating on that. So Tenants and Neighbors is an organization in Manhattan. They're headquartered in Manhattan, but they cover those counties that I told you, where we have so many avaricious landlords. I'd like to bring to your attention again these vegetarian meat analogs, Big Frank's, chili, chocolates, dinner cuts. These are all made from soybean, fried chicken, linkettes, prime steaks, saucettes, savory prime, a dinner loaf, what is good, scallops, Swiss steaks, tender bits, tender rounds, tuna, I do not recommend it, Vegilinks. The best of all the vegetarian hot dogs are Leanies. They're frozen. Veggie burger, vegetarian burger, and vegetable steaks. And here's another whole page of them. Where do you get them? I would go to a Seventh-day Adventist church. They always have a health food store in the back of the church. This is a thank you from Public Access in Washington, D.C. For the $30 that I sent them. Thank you. And thank you, Karen Beasley. Oh, see what else is going on. Here's the corrupt New York State Commission on Judicial Conduct. Do nothing. Just like the courts, you know. They're supposed to protect you from bad judges. That's a constitutional right for the state of New York Constitution. Do they? No. Andrew Spano is getting stuck up. He used to lean on Glendora back in the old days when he wanted publicity. Glendora gave it to him. Now he thinks he's a big shot and he won't return telephone calls. Maybe it's his secretary's fault. Could be. And I decided, folks, that I'm going to stick with God, you know. You can do what you want, but that's where it is, and I'm sticking with God. And I want you to be one with God's power, God's success, God's...